It is a good day to be together. It's always a good day to be together. You know, it's I miss this fellowship, you know, during the week. I do meet with other people at different times, but with the full body gathering together to worship God is such a great, great thing. So, I invite you to stand if we'd like to and are able. And this is a memory verse that we're working on for a while. We're just going to see this yellow slip of paper out there. If you'd like to take one home and work on it. So let's read this together. God is our refuge and strength, a helper who is always found in times of trouble. Psalm 46:1. Let me give you a way to help you memorize. Next slide, please, Chris. Took out some words. Just put some, I've done this before myself. Just put a letter there. So let's read it together if you can remember it. God is our refuge and strength, a helper who is always found in times of trouble. Psalm 46:1. Just if you remember. So, but that's just a good way to help you remember scriptures. Whatever scripture you're trying to memorize, it just gives us more opportunities to fill in the blanks to where eventually you don't need any helps at all. We are here because God is our refuge and strength. And let's sing about this. My God is all I need.
So strong and so mighty, there's nothing my God can do.
great truth there. God is all we need. He is my refuge and strength. He's always there as a helper in what we need. And we have all of this because of what Jesus Christ has done for us, the great sacrifice. We have that victory in Jesus. So let's sing this great hymn together. Sometimes we just kind of forget that, but that's the most important thing to remember, is the victory we have in Christ. In the book of Ephesians, it speaks about this, in Ephesians chapter 1, it's the great truth of why we're here. Blessed is the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavens in Christ. For he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless in love before him. He predestined us to be adopted as sons through Jesus Christ for himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace that he lavished on us in the beloved one. In him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace that he richly poured out on us with all wisdom and understanding. This is what we have in Christ. This is who we are in Christ. Let's go to the Lord in prayer before we sing. Father, we thank you again for who you are. God, you have given us victory in Christ, not because of what we've done, but because of what you've done through your Son, Jesus. Father, we thank you that you are almighty. God, that there is nothing that you can't work through in our lives. There's no boundary, no sin that you cannot overcome. Father, we thank you that before the foundation of the world, God, you loved us and sent Jesus in this plan to die for us and to raise up again and live forevermore. Father, may we continue to praise you. May we, our lives say, my Jesus, I love you. May we sing this with all of our heart. In Jesus' name, amen. Kristen gave me a look, so I guess not. We'll forget that part. I'm very thankful for a church that cares for, loves on children. And knowing that children are children, right? They make marks, they do things, you know, as children do. I'm very thankful that we love that. We don't necessarily love it when we adults act childish, but, you know, so don't draw on the walls if you would. We appreciate that. Been talking about change. You see my scene change. If you don't, you can't figure that out. Scene change. It's a change that is seen.
We've experienced this recently where we had just a lot of brownness out there. And then the Lord, in His great blessing, sent a bunch of whiteness through snow and made it incredibly beautiful. And now that snow is melting away, and we know that there's been another great change coming when those little green things are starting to pop out, and we see flowers again, and the temperatures rise. Change. We love the change. And sometimes we just don't notice the change, though, in what is happening. You did notice that, right? Yeah, that was kind of red, now it's green. All right. But the change should be seen in what God does in our life. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, remember that's the title of Jesus, the King title, Messiah title, anointed the title. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Not going to be, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, and see, the new has come. Because of Jesus, because of our faith in what he has done, because of our faith in what he continues, who he continues to be, there should be a seen change in our life. A seen change. And though this change here is an immediate, spiritual, eternal change. It's an immediate spiritual change when we are redeemed at that moment of faith. If it's a true change of salvation, then there will be a seen change in our life. So I sent out a question this week, this weekend, and I said, within your friendships, who do you see trying to live their lives for Jesus and sharing that life with others? So I sent out these questions just to get our mind thinking to today and what I'm talking about. By the way, if you're not on our text list, just write down your phone number and your name, and I'll get you on that text list. Hopefully, when even you've heard that question now, who within your friendships do you see basically Jesus in? Hopefully somebody comes to your mind, and actually more hopefully that more people come to your mind. That you've seen this change, this new creation change happen in their life. This gospel good news of Jesus Christ. Paul, we talked about, he's someone who was changed radically by God. He was a hater of Jesus. He was a hater of people who followed Jesus. But because of an encounter with God, Jesus Christ, his whole life changed. Immediately transferred from hell to heaven. We'll talk a little bit more in a second. But he was changed. And so last week we looked at the beginning of this letter to Philemon. It's only 25 verses long. And this is what it says. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and co-worker. So we looked at these men who've been changed by God. Ordinary men who've been changed by their faith in Christ. So, to Philemon and our dear friend and co-worker, to Apphia, our sister, to Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church that meets in your home. This is a family of change. This was Philemon, his wife, and son, adult son. That family had been changed by their faith in Jesus Christ. Not only that, you see a church, that the body of other Christians were meeting in that home. And so it was not just a physical family, but a spiritual family. We all are family of God if we have given our life to Jesus Christ, transformed him by him. And then the next verse said, grace to you and peace from God our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember, and these are those y'all words. Remember our English is like kind of limited. And so these are y'all. These first three verses are talking to all the people. And so this is a personal change that happens. I'm not changed because my parents got saved. I'm only changed when I place my faith in Jesus Christ. It is a personal change. Although we've all been personally changed, we have this corporate change here, together change. So let's continue on to this letter. And by the way, it's a great letter. I have tried to put it in my life to write letters to people. I mean, we don't do that very often anymore. You know, it's a lot easier to text, a lot easier to email, but a personal letter written by your hand. My handwriting's horrible, so if you ever get a letter from me, you might need to decipher it, but I try to be neat. But writing a letter of this personal love for Christ, love for them, love for God and all he's doing. So this is what he says in Philemon verses 4 through 7. I always thank my God when I mention you in my prayers. And this is that singular you. No more y'alls in the rest of this. I always thank my God when I mention you in my prayers because I hear of your love for all the saints and the faith that you have in the Lord Jesus. I pray that your participation in the faith may become effective through knowing every good thing that is in us for the glory of God. For I have great joy and encouragement from your love because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, brother. So let's first look at the source of change. True change in a Christian life comes from the outside. Goes on the inside, which changes our outside. But the outside source is God. This is why I love Paul when he's writing, because he always does this. I always thank my God when I mention you in my prayers. So Paul is a praying man. A lot of times, what we do and what we like is, man, I thank you, John, for your life. Man, you're a rock star. You are super. You're the best husband. I get these letters all the time. You're the best. Where they're just praising you. And we all want that. But Paul is understanding this true source of change. And he's saying, I thank God. I thank God for you. Because he understands it's God's work in all of our lives. I thank God for you when I mention you in my prayers. So Paul is praying for Philemon. Paul is thanking God for this relationship, this fellowship he has with this man, Philemon. I always thank God. And so he understands it is God that changes his life. It's a power that has done this. It is the plan of God who sent Jesus to this world. And this power is displayed when we come to Christ. He already said, we already read that, you know, we become this new creation. All the old is gone. Everything is new. But we're trusting in the one who can change us. We're trusting in the one, in Jesus, who came to this earth and died, took the punishment, the wrath of God for our sins. And we're not trusting in ourselves for this. God's grace, remember, grace is something we are given that we don't deserve. When we think we deserve something, pretty much are wrong. All that we have comes from God. Because he's a loving God, he's a caring God, he's a giving God. And this is what he has done. Colossians 1, 13 and 14, he has rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of the Son he loves. So this is where we all were before we came to Christ. We were all in this kingdom, in this domain of darkness, of evil. Have you ever been in a cave and had no lights? I mean, sometimes, you know, we lose lights, but there's typically some sort of light source somewhere. You know, either the moon outside or something. Here we go in the deepest part of a cave and turn off the lights. It's almost crushing, that darkness. But we were in the crushing darkness of sin, the crushing darkness of God's wrath on us. And because God is such a good God, through Jesus Christ, he has rescued us from that domain, that kingdom of darkness, and transferred us, taken us out of that, put us now into the kingdom of the Son he loves. And this is what has happened. In him, in Jesus, we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. The forgiveness of sins. I'm going to just take a pause here because my wife keeps talking to me and asking me about these things up here, these crates and the... She said, black crate's ugly. Why do you have it up there? I said, we're going to get to it. We're going to get to it next week. I'll tell you. Just tell me. But it has something to do with this up here. In Him, in Jesus Christ, we have redemption. We have been bought. We now have the forgiveness of sins. We struggle with forgiving people. But God does not through Jesus Christ. For those who come to Him, this is what we have. The forgiveness for all those past things we've ever thought, said, or done that were wrong against God or wrong against people, which is wrong against people is wrong against God. The things that we say, think, do today, tomorrow, until we die. All of that punishment, all the wrath of God was placed on Jesus for that, and we have been forgiven for all of it. He has rescued us. He has changed us because the source of change has done this, God Almighty. But also in this passage, we see the sound of change. This has nothing to do with this, but the sound of change just brings back this memory that happened a couple days ago. I was at Walmart. I went to the self-checkout thing, and the guy was waiting for it, and those people left. And I heard something as they walked away, and I was like, what's that? I looked down, and there was some change, because they used cash to pay, and the change fell. The sound of change fell there. So I said, hey, you know, you left your change, you know, like, don't worry about it. No, I said, I don't want it. Take your change. And so they came back, got their change. That has nothing to do with this, but I thought I'd just give that little information to you. The sound of change, this is what we hear here. So going back to verse 4, Paul says, I always thank my God when I mention you in my prayers because I hear of your love for all the saints and the faith that you have in the Lord Jesus. I hear of your love and the faith that you have. This is amazing. This is before the U.S. mail system came into place, email, texting, internet, hearing of Philemon's love and faith. That means this is a word of mouth that's happening. We have that around today, but this is a great hearing. That Paul, who is hundreds of miles away, sometimes in prison, sometimes, he's in prison here, sometimes not, but he hears of the news of people he has ministered to, churches he's helped, and says, I hear this. And specifically here is, I'm hearing about your love for all the saints. Now, some people have this word messed up, but what saints in the scriptures mean is us. If we have come to Christ, we have been forgiven. We have been redeemed, and the Bible says we all are saints. So I am St. John the Baptist. St. John, you're St. whoever, St. Redonda. That's who we are, according to God, not by our power, not by our works, but God has given this to us. And that's why Paul says, I'm hearing, Philemon, that you love all the saints, which is amazing, because sometimes we struggle with loving other Christians. But people are talking about Philemon and how he loves the body of Christ. He's not a Superman. He's a man. He's not a pastor. He's a man. He's a husband. He's a father. He is leading somewhat in helping the church. The church meets at his house. But he's just an ordinary guy. And people were talking about this ordinary guy who loved through the love of God, the people of God. It also says, he's hearing about the faith that he has in Jesus. Now faith, again, is hearing or reading God's word and acting upon that. You're believing in his God's word, you're acting upon it. So yes, he at some point had placed his faith in Jesus Christ for salvation. But he hasn't stopped there. He's still growing in Christ. He's still reading the Old Testament is all he has. That's picturing and pointing to Christ. And he's growing that way. And people are seeing this love he has for people, but also his love for Jesus, his wanting to follow Jesus. So here, I mean, it's, you know, as I'm studying, it's like, okay. First of all, do you love, actively love, purposefully love the saints of God, the people of God? Love is not just this word we say. Love is heartfelt, it's purposeful, it's action. That's what people had seen in Philemon, and that's what Paul heard. But the question then goes beyond that. Do others see this about you? I asked you the question, do you see it in others? But do others see this in you? Do you think people are talking about you in this way? Well, the source of change is really happening in your life and changing you. There is going to be a sound of change in others. They're going to be talking about just something they see about you, you know, as you're following God. And that's an amazing thing. Because again, I look at my life and man, I don't like what I see at times. But I do go back and say, God, you've changed me so much. You've changed my heart, my thinking, my words. I'm not perfect. I'm still in this growth pattern. But I thank God for that. And I thank God for what I see in you. The source of change, the sound of change, and then the strengthening change. Strengthening change. Philemon 6, verse 6 says, I pray, Paul again is praying, that your participation in the faith may become effective through knowing every good thing that is in us, some translations say in you, for the glory of Christ. We see that Paul is praying for a continued participation in faith, in the faith, as he follows Christ. Active following. And then in this prayer, that it becomes effective. That it is outward. It is inward too, because our faith in Christ brings us hope and encouragement and peace and joy. But our life in Christ is not just meant for us. It's meant to share. To share among the body of Christ. And then take it out to the world and share as we can. It is something that is seen. That is experienced. And also knowing every good thing. For in us, in Christ, for all followers of Christ. Because God is such a good God. There are so many good things that God does in our lives. And he does it as a whole. He does it individuals. We're all unique. Again, we've got twins and they're completely different. Some of you have twins and they're different. And they may look alike, ours don't, but they're different. All of us are different. Uniquely made by God. And so there's these good things that God is doing in all of us. And so Paul is praying that Philemon's faith may continue to grow and may continue to be effective, that he's knowing what God is doing in himself and what God is doing in others. And it's all for the glory of Christ. All for the glory of Christ. Not our own glory, not for the glory of the church, but for the glory of God. Strengthening change. That means there's an effort that takes place. If you ever have to take a physical test, I don't have to take a physical test, thankfully. But if you do, you got to get your body ready for that test. You got to strengthen your body. And we need to continue to strengthen our faith. There's been years of my life where it's just like static or downward. Instead of purposefully strengthening my faith in God. And that comes from his word. Studying it, looking at it, memorizing it. Placing it in my faith. Talking to others about it. Having fellowship and prayer and worship. And this overall seeing change strengthens us. But again, not just for ourselves. This is the last verse from Philemon we're looking at. Where Paul says, for I have great joy and encouragement from your love, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, brother. So first, Paul saying, Philemon, you're such an encouragement to me. You don't understand that. You're far away, but But me hearing about what God is doing in your life is such an encouragement for you. You know, if you're on social media and somebody there you see has encouraged you through Christ, just write, "You're just an awesome person. How great you are." No. See, I thank God for you. I mean, what a great thing. But actually thank God for him before you write that. Don't just write words. Do what it says. I thank God for you because, man, you're an encouragement to me. So Paul says, "Man, I have joy. I have encouragement because of you. Because of your love." And then, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, brother. We all know some people who drain us. Opposite of refreshment. Sometimes we're draining because we don't know we're draining on people. But we should be refreshers in Christ because we love to be refreshed in Christ. That's what this time together is such a refreshment for me. It is. You know, "John, you're the pastor. I get down. I have struggles. I need the refreshment of others. I need the refreshment not just here, but from times for others." And we need that, all of that. Because some of you are going through some really hard times right now. You're going through some very difficult times in physical and in family life. And you're going, "Man, what can I do? I need something." And God says, "I want to refresh you." And God refreshes us, yes, through his word, through our time with him. But God refreshes us through the brothers and sisters in Christ. And we need to be that refreshment for others as we follow Christ, as we grow in love for Christ. 1 Thessalonians 5:11, "Therefore encourage one another and build each other up as you're already doing." Paul's writing this to a bunch of Christians in Thessalonica. And this is what he's heard about them. This is what he's experienced about from them. That they're an encouraging people. They're a building up people. It's easy to discourage. It's easy to tear down somebody. But God says, we are to be the opposite of that. We're to be encouragers. We're to be builders up. Not false. Because we see the rest of this letter as Paul writes about different things. We need to be this. So therefore, encourage one another. Build up one another. In the book of Hebrews 10:23, "Let us hold on to the confession of our hope without wavering, since he who promised is faithful." In other words, God is the source of all our strength. We need to hold on to him. Hold on to our confession of our faith in Jesus Christ. Hold on to your confession as, "I'm going to live for you, Jesus." Keep on holding on to that. We're going to struggle at times, but hold on. The next verse, verse 24, says, "And let us consider one another in order to provoke love and good works." That provoke word is a stirring up word. I love to camp. Don't camp much anymore, but love to camp and campfires. We still put fires out there, and I love fires. I love playing in fires, you know, but you have those coals down there, so I'm not done going yet. And so you stir up those coals and get them going, and you blow on them or whatever, you add some more stuff to stir up those things, to get them on fire again. And this is what, you're holding on to your confession yourself. You're strengthening yourself, and then you're moving outward. "Let us consider one another in order to strengthen, provoke, stir up love and good works in others." This is what Paul has been writing to Philemon. "Man, I see this in you, and it is so awesome." In that very next verse, not neglecting to gather together, as some are in the habit of doing. You'll pause there for one. This doesn't mean you can't miss, but the habit of that. Meet with two different groups of pastors at times, and we talk about this, is that we talked about COVID here recently and just the positives that COVID helped us in trying to minister to people. And one of that is that little black thing we have here is being online, putting that online. But some people use it as an excuse. And if you're watching and use it as an excuse, shame on you. Repent, turn. I'm telling you. If you can get to a service, this is what it's talking. It's talking to you. But it says, don't neglect this because it can become a habit. I've been in that habit before. And I know what my life did when that habit took place. Because I'm not strengthening myself. I'm not encouraging one another. But this is what the command is for us, is that we now, but encouraging one another. And all the more as you see the day approaching, that means the day that is coming that Jesus returns. You know, too many people are saying, look, a terrible world we live in. Is it bad? Yes. Is it the worst ever? No. And again, that's almost, I say this a lot, I'm going to keep on saying, don't watch the news so much. They're not encouraging people. They're not a building up people. Right? They want you to fear so you can watch and see what you have to fear tomorrow, the next time. I didn't say cut it out, but don't watch it so much. Are you reading more of God's Word than you are listening to news? I'm done. But the day is approaching, meaning it's going to get worse than we've ever imagined before Jesus comes back. And we're going to need that encouragement from one another to stay strong in the Lord, to follow the Lord, to be those people of love and hope and joy and peace for each other and beyond. And so we need to be praising and thanking the source of change, God Almighty. Because He is working in our lives. He is doing great things. And we need to thank Him for what He's done in our lives and thank Him for what we see in other people's lives. The sound of change. We need to be those people who are those sounders. Saying, did you see what I saw in try to think of a word, that's a name. Stefano. We have a Stephanie, but it's Stefano. You know, do you see Stefano? Because I just love how he encouraged me this past week. And we're telling others about other people in good ways instead of down ways. We need to be the sound of change, and we need to be the people that people are sounding about. That people see it in us, but we also praising God and telling others of what we see in others. And so then the strengthening of change, we need to continue to be getting stronger in love and faith in this purposeful outward and inward through His Word, through obedience, through worship, through prayer. Because, you know, I talked about the end day approaching. Sometimes in your own life, it seems like the end of the world is happening. That's why we're encouraging one another. But some people are right out there because it seems like the end of the world is happening right now. Reaching out, encouraging, loving on them, praying for them, being real with them. So that we all experience this change, and it's changing even more for the glory of God. So finish on this verse, going back to that verse 4. Paul says, I always thank my God when I mention you in my prayers. This is such a key to it, is praying for other people. I mean, it is not wrong to pray for yourself. You can go to the Psalms. Amen. As a matter of fact, Paul says, man, pray for me. We need people to pray. We need to pray for ourselves, but we need to be praying for other people. In positive ways. Yes, there's people who are struggling, but also thank God for the people in your life. Even thanking God for going backwards to God using people in your life to get you to this point right now. I've done that recently of just, God, how did I get here in my life? Not just here in Coal Valley, but how did I get here in my life? Going back and just seeing how God has used people in my family, outside my family. Circumstances, good and bad, to bring me to this point of my faith in Christ. I always thank my God. Let me tell you, this is where I am right now too. I thank my God for this church. What God has done, what He's going to do, because it's the people of the church. I don't do it enough. And again, this, as I'm studying this, God is saying, John, Yes. And so we're going to close on a prayer, a praise, a prayer to God that says, take my life and let it be consecrated to you. And so this morning, this letter that Paul writes to Philemon, take that and make it a prayer to God for people in your own life. And then ask God to make your life so drastically changed from right now that people see even more of Christ in you. The continued joy. Let's pray. Father, I thank you that you love us. You loved us while we were still sinners, while we were rebels. You loved us while we were so far away, while we loved the sinfulness of this world and pleasures of sin. God, when we thought we were all that, we were nothing. Lord, all we deserve is just your wrath, God, because of your great love. You sent Jesus to die for us. And Father, I do pray for someone here who's never committed their life to you, truly committed their life to you, that right now they would do that. It's through faith. But God, then they would say something to somebody today about that. But Lord, I know that most of us here are yours. May we be that same change for each other and for this world. For your glory and your glory alone, God. Take my life. God, take my life. Help me to be consecrated in following you, loving the saints, and loving the lost enough to share the hope of Jesus with them. I pray this in his name. Amen. Let's stand as we sing this hymn.
Or if anybody else, or you can fill out a yellow slip and back and put it in the box lunch to the pastor's office. Upcoming birthdays, February 2nd, Eric Cook. Now, Mondays, we get together at Vibrant Coffee House, meet at 8:30 in the morning, coffee and fellowship. And then Young Adult Bible Study, they meet also at Vibrant Coffee House on Tuesdays at 5:30. Men's Prayer, Wednesdays at 8 a.m., meet here. And then after that, then they'll go to Flip's Pancakes House. And Wednesday night Bible study is from 6:30 to 7:15. What? Well, here, I got what do angels do, and you got what do they do?
It's the same thing.
Okay.
Just trying to throw it out, Brian.
But you did a good job. All right, then we got offering. If you feel to give, we have offering box in back, or you can go back online and give online. Next thing we have is John.
Yeah, this last week we'll mention this. If you want receipts for your giving records for last year, there's a little white slip of paper out there. Just put your name on that, and then we'll get your receipts, or your gifts from last year. If you want it for tax purposes or just for own purposes.
Next, we have Women's Ministries.
All right. 1 week from today will be our Women's Ministry meeting, and we'll be meeting downstairs at 3 o'clock to 5 o'clock. Our topic will be friendship. So I think it's going to be a very good meeting for the month of February, which is kind of our, I don't want to say love month, but you know, Valentine's Day and all. We're going to be talking about friendship with women and friendship with God. So I hope you can all make it, ladies.
You got one other one.
Okay. Young Ladies Meet is coming up on February 15th. That's a Thursday night from 6:30 to 8 o'clock downstairs. And be sure to bring your book and your folder. We have no homework or hard work due this time. And so it's just going to be a really good time of sharing. So I hope all of our young ladies and mothers can make it.
Disaster relief.
Yeah, so it's coming up on the 24th. Again, all this is on our website. You already mentioned that. But it's just being trained for where you can get to go into different areas to help out with mud out, that's cleaning up houses. Sometimes you're taking off the sheetrock and stuff, or feeding. We do this, we've done this in the Quad Cities with floods in previous years, but also sometimes there's bigger parks. With shower units, anyway, it's on this date, it's $50. Talk to me if you'd like to sign up on that. I'll give you an easy way to do that. And there.
All right,
nice to meet
you. Generations.
All right, so Generations Conference is for parenting and grandparents too. But it's on March 2nd from 9:30 to 3:30. $50 includes, $30 includes lunch. There's free child care for 12 and under during that time. There's three things coming up very quickly. This is not, you have to pick one, not the others. If this is where God wants you to go, go to this. The next one is Iron Sharpens Iron on that same day. This is just for men. This is a little longer, but it's 8:34. Great conference, great breakouts. This is $50, which includes your lunch. On any of these, if you're struggling financially, just talk to us. We'd be glad to help. We have some scholarship money to help you out in any of these places. And then the next one.
All right, is the Iron Sharpens Iron for Women. So we're going to participate this year in the Women's Conference, and it will be April 13th. It'll be at Calvary Church in Moline, and top-notch speakers. It's going to be excellent, just a way to learn more about our faith and how to share it, and it's going to be a great time. It is also $50, and I will leave the money by the end of March so that we can get in on the early registration discount. So again, ladies, hope you can make that too. If you have questions, let me know.
By the way, if you've ever been to the men's Iron Sharpens Men, just stand up real quick so people can see. If they have any answers, questions that you can ask any of us, there's a lot more, they're not here, but there's some in the back all the way around. So ask them if you have any questions on that. Any other announcements we missed this morning? Want to make up one? No? Okay. Continue praying for one another. We have some people Melissa's having a surgery on her arm this morning, or not this morning, Wednesday. Wednesday. Continue to pray for Ginger. She's recovering from hip surgery. Again, just pray for one another. God brings these things to your mind for a reason. Just pray for them. All right. Let's stand as we close with this great song learned as a kid, taught kids. If you want to do the motions, it's okay. It is. I'm going to do the not the emotions, but the motions. Do this.
My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty. There's nothing my God cannot do. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty. There's nothing my God cannot do. The mountains are His, the valleys are His, the stars are His.
Amen. Have a great week.